Hi, Henk Akmans here. Supply Network Dynamics, Chapter 3, Part 8, Organizational Filters. So far we've had that people don't take optimal decisions. They are happy with good enough, satisfying solutions. We call that bounded rationality. We've had that there are considerable cognitive filters, so things we are as humans simply not good at, delays, accumulation, feedback. And we've had behavioral filters, so even if we are good at all those things, then we can be brought in certain settings, we can be primed, framed in such a way that actually we are not at our best behavior. We rely on system one, quick heuristics, whereas we should be using system two, more the contemplative analytical side of our brain. Now we've had all that, and now we get people where there are the cognitive filters have been overcome, the behavioral filters are not active, and yet they do not take good decisions, good in the sense of best for the network or the organization as a whole. They take decisions which are sensible for their own career. That's why the subtitle here is On the Organizational Perils of Sharing Data and Making Objective Decisions. There is a long literature, but also an old literature on reasons why people don't take the best possible decisions because they are very smart. Simon is one of the first, again, a Nobel Prize winner, heroes from the 1950s and 60s. We've had Kahneman and Tversky, but I think another hero of mine is Russ Eckhoff. And there is the idea of management information systems, the commonly used term for all the decision making and information gathering for managers in the 90s, 60s, 70s, 80s. And he wrote an article called Management Misinformation Systems, in which he gives five assumptions commonly made by people who are into management information systems. Nowadays, we would probably call this business intelligence, BI, and which are simply wrong. Here's the first one. Managers need more information. No. Even in the 1960s, managers were buried with so long before big data. Here's a quote from his article from, again, 1967. Managers receive much more data than they can possibly absorb. Their problem is information overload. They do not have not enough information. They do not have good information. And the focus is difficult to get. Second assumption, which is incorrect. Managers need the information they want. No. Managers often want the information they do not need. Another quote. One cannot specify what information is required for decision making until there is something like an explanatory model for the decision process that has been constructed. Notice that the idea of making a model of a complex setting is essential to this entire course. And Eckhoff made that point some 45 years ago. So unless you really know what it is that you need to decide upon, you have no chance understanding what information you need. So there's a new venture, a new activity, or there's a problem in your company that needs to be solved. What information do you need on that? Well, first you have to understand the venture, you have to understand the problem, and then you can look for information that says more about the precise status of that problem or of the venture. Third one, managers will make better decisions if they have more information. No, although that sounds really simple because, well, at best they could not improve when they have more information. But no, actually, it's the opposite way. Why? Well, because manager may have an incentive to do things which are better for their part of the organization, where they are responsible for, but which are not so good for the entire part. And a classical example is sales and operations. If people in sales have more information on what's happening in operations, you would hope that they do the right thing. But it may also be that they assume then you know what, perhaps I should exaggerate my my future sales a little bit so that operation will allocate some more scarce capacity to me. We'll see in chapter 5, for instance, a case where that's the what that is happening between customers, but also your own sales department then and operations. And the other way around for operations is operations knows already about certain plans that sales has. It may anticipate on it and therefore make those plans futile. And another reason is that you have to understand the stuff. So if you got insights from queuing theory, statistics, supply, system dynamics, you already saw those may not at all be obvious. So if they have more information, but they do not know how to process the information, it's of little use. Fourth one, more communication means better performance. Also pretty much the point that I had before this. The quote that Eckhoff has here, when organizational units have inappropriate measure of performance and they put them in conflict with another, well, if you have more information about the other side, that will not help, will help your fight against the other side, but actually it's not the other side. But if you're incentivized to see the other part of the organization as the other side, this will not be helpful. Last one, still true. A manager doesn't have to understand how an information system works. That's for the geek, that's for the IT side. Forget it. Because this may lead to very erroneous conclusions. The information system may be wrong, or the number may be in a very specific interpretation. An example that I remember from my own background is where a semiconductor company had a measure for stocks that was based on the percentage of how much stock you would have was calculated based on the number of complete shipments. So if you would be asked 10 and you could ship 9, then that's 0% full shipments. But they assumed it was 90%. So it's the percentage of shipments that you have on time. Now, what they didn't know was that their IT system was working on the first way of calculating a service level. And so they had far too much stock. They didn't know this. They didn't know this until, in this case, my advisor Will Bertrand looked into the precise equations and found out that was actually the case. So no, as a manager, you need to understand also the insight of the systems, how the data that you get presented are actually calculated. More is not better. Here's an example from case 5, 6, 7. Interpolis SRB case. In this case, and we'll see it again when we get to this chapter, this was an insurance company, and the management team had a list of over 100 variables that in a big spreadsheet that they were supposed to take into account, but they didn't. What we did is we made an explanatory model of what it was that was important to them. This is what you see on the left-hand side. And from that, they made a scorecard, a balanced scorecard of just between 10 and 12 key performance indicators that they could focus on. And so then they could collect data on these things, not on the pile of over 100. Nobody can actually understand 100. Another hero, a set of heroes, is James March, also active in there. And March and Olson is a classical reference to the garbage can model of organizational choice. So we assume, and some assignment it is also, that first you have a problem and then you do some analysis and you have a decision. But actually, my personal experience in the last quarter of a century fits nicely with this finding from 1972 when I was not even a student, is that in organization, a better model of thinking about how decisions are made is that these are problems, possible solutions for problems, people who might or may not have a problem, opportunities to take that to take a decision, and they're all floating around in this garbage can, which is the organization. And unless there is a good opportunity to make a decision, there's a crisis in the market, Somebody was blocking a certain ID, leaves, or a new manager is coming in, or there's a big opportunity, or there's a very demanding customer, something that makes an opportunity for a choice. No decision will be made. The solution has often been around for 5 or 10 years, may have been forgotten, needs to be rediscovered, may have been discarded, may have not worked in the past. But if you have the right fit of the opportunity for the choice, the right problem to apply a certain solution, the solution itself and the right participants, the people who can push it through, then something will happen. But the linear mode doesn't exist. It's there in a big soup or a garbage can, as Martin Olsen told. Described it, and that's the way decisions are made. So that we have to realize also that even if the solution is quite clear, it may not be the decision to implement the decision, a solution may not be taken. And then we come to an example, which I will go into in the next part.